Hello, Bee here, and welcome back to Biology. Quick quiz, what's the smallest thing we've learned about in this course? We talk about cells a lot, but we've learned about things even smaller than cells, like the organelles that make up cells, or the atoms and molecules that build the organelles. The universe seems to naturally organize its contents into a hierarchy of levels, as shown here. Cells organize into tissues and organs that make the whole organism, and we know that a group of organisms of the same species is called a population. We haven't talked as much about the bigger levels shown here, like biocenosis, ecosystems, and biomes. So that will be our topic for today. But before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to identify and describe the various levels of organization in living things. Give examples of interactions between living things in a community. And explain how biotic and abiotic factors interact with each other in ecosystems and the biosphere. The first level we'll look at today is called biocenosis. This level is also sometimes called a biological community. On the diagram, we can see that it is one level above population. Remember that to be considered a population, a group of organisms must all be the same species, and they must live in the same geographic area, like this population of sea stars. But most populations don't live in isolation. They share their physical space with many other species. This coral reef biocenosis contains many living things: sea stars, many species of colorful fish, and coral. A biocenosis is a group of populations living in the same area and interacting. The living parts that make up a biocenosis are called biotic factors. Remember that the prefix bio always means living. These biotic factors could be plants, animals, bacteria, fungi, even protists and archaea. And we know from our previous lesson that all living things need energy. So those food webs we looked at last time all occur within a biocenosis, so that energy can flow from one trophic level to the next, right up the food chain. Within a community, some animals are predators and others are prey. Predators are animals that hunt other animals for food. The animals that are hunted are the prey. Which animal is the predator here? The lion, because she has just captured a zebra, which will make a tasty meal. Lions are secondary consumers because they are carnivores. The zebra is the prey and is also a primary consumer or herbivore. Can you think of any animals that might sometimes be the predators, but other times be the prey? Frogs spend their days hunting bugs and worms, until they themselves are hunted by a lizard, or maybe a large bird. Remember that food webs are complex and have many levels. So we now know that all of the living things together in a physical space make up the biocenosis, or community. But what about the non-living or abiotic factors? These have an effect on what life can survive in an area as well. When we combine the living and non-living factors that interact in a physical area, this makes up the ecosystem. What are the biotic factors in this ecosystem? I see trees, grass, rabbits, a bear, many fish, a bird, a fox, and a jellyfish. We can't see it, but there are almost certainly bacteria, archaea, fungi, and protist species living in the soil. What about the abiotic factors? There is a large mountain made of rock, as well as smaller rocks, water in the river, and air making up the atmosphere. Physical characteristics of the area, such as temperature, are also abiotic factors. To be considered a biotic or an abiotic factor, something has to have an impact on the life in the ecosystem. How does temperature affect living things? Well, when it's cold outside, organisms tend to become less active and huddle together for warmth. When the temperature is higher, they become more active and metabolize more quickly. You may even remember that this particular abiotic factor brought about a mass extinction. 250 million years ago, at the end of the Permian period, most living things went extinct. Rising global temperatures sped up the metabolism of many organisms, especially in the oceans. This caused those organisms to use up oxygen too quickly, and the world suffocated without it. Other abiotic factors that affect ecosystems include water and soil. Living things need not only an adequate supply of soil and water, but the quality matters too. Clean, fresh water and healthy, nutrient-rich soil are critical to living things, and the decline of these factors has put many species at risk of extinction in recent years. There are three main types of ecosystems, known as biomes, that we will explore further in the next lesson. Terrestrial ecosystems are land-based and include biomes such as rainforests, savannas, deserts, and tundras. Aquatic ecosystems are divided into freshwater biomes such as lakes, rivers, and swamps, while marine biomes include coral reefs, the open ocean, and the deep ocean. The highest level of ecological organization is the biosphere. You could probably dissect this word and make a pretty good guess about what it means. Any ideas? Bio means living, and a sphere is the shape of the Earth. So the biosphere simply means all the living parts of Earth. Or we could think of it as the parts of Earth where living things exist. How much of the Earth is considered part of the biosphere? We know from a previous lesson that living things make up far less than 1% of the total mass of the Earth. But you may also know that living things spread out across almost the entire surface of Earth and across all the Earth's oceans. Most life exists within a region that begins 1,000 feet below the ocean's surface and extends to approximately 3 miles above the surface. The biosphere is divided into three layers. The lithosphere includes all of the solid land masses, such as continents and islands. We find life here such as trees, bears, shrubs, tortoises, grasses, and giraffes. Oh, and of course, humans. But life isn't only found on land. The atmosphere, which is the gaseous region above the surface, supports life as well. Many species of birds inhabit this zone, as well as flying insects and bats. The third part of the biosphere is the hydrosphere. This includes all of the lakes, oceans, and other bodies of water that support life. The hydrosphere is home to many species of fish and invertebrates like corals, many large marine mammals such as manatees, and even marine plants and algae that do photosynthesis and provide oxygen to the rest of the biosphere. The biosphere is a complex and interconnected system that supports life by cycling nutrients, water, and oxygen. In an earlier unit, we looked at the water, carbon, and nitrogen cycles that occur on Earth. Because these specifically affect living things on Earth, we could also say that they occur in the biosphere. And we've seen examples in this unit of energy and nutrients being cycled and transferred through the biosphere in food webs and energy pyramids. The biosphere is largely shaped by natural geological processes, such as the shifting of continental plates, volcanic activity, and large-scale weather patterns. But human activity can affect the biosphere as well, in both positive and negative ways. Because all life on Earth depends on the interactions in the biosphere, it's in our best interest as humans to make sure it is protected so that it remains capable of sustaining life. As we went through the lesson today, we reviewed populations and looked at biological communities, which consist of all the living things in a region and are also called a biocenosis. When we add the non-living parts of the habitat, this makes up the ecosystem. Next time, we'll look more closely at the different types of ecosystems called biomes. And we ended our lesson learning about the biosphere, which encompasses all of the living parts of Earth. In the lesson PDF, you'll explore the greenhouse effect and look at how it shapes our biosphere. Until next time, remember that biology isn't just science, it's the way of life.